Hello, everyone. This is Colleen Francis from Engage Selling Solutions. Thank you so much for joining us today. I am really excited about our content today. I think it's going to be a jam-packed, content-filled. Well, I shouldn't say I think. I know it's going to be jam-packed, full of content. You are going to want to get a pen, a piece of paper, or if you can type. While you're looking at your screen, you can do that too. I'm not very good at that kind of multitasking, but I do want to make sure that you have lots of room to take notes so that you can implement everything that's going to be covered today. I am coming from live from our Ottawa office today, and I hope all of you in the North East, I guess, whether it's Ontario, Quebec, Pennsylvania, New York, are safe and protected from the fires, are staying indoors. We apparently have the worst air quality in Canada right now, and New York, I think, has the worst air quality in North America right now. So keep your pets indoors and safe prayers for all of you who might be battling this a little closer to home. It's a not an easy time for any of us right now. So, as we're getting set, I would love to hear from you guys. Where are you tuning in from? Where are you located? How's your year going? Over the next few months, over the summer, we're going to be really diving deep into some of the topics that you've asked me to cover and that I know need to be covered in order for everyone to have a really strong end of year. And that is why I am so excited about today's guest. So, David, before I introduce you, David, how long have we known each other?
Gosh, it must be 10, 12 years at least, maybe more, maybe
Yes.
even 15.
I was thinking, I don't want to age us.
Right. Well, we met when I was 12 and you were 9.
You go. I think that that's about right. But I have known David in a professional capacity for maybe 10, 12, 15 years, and he always has amazing insights to share. You are going to see on this call that David and I share a joint passion for selling and marketing and really showcasing your value. So let me introduce him professionally first. David Newman is a certified speaking professional and a member of the NSA Million Dollars Speaker Group. David is the author of the business bestsellers Do It Marketing, Do It Speaking, and Do It Selling. I love that. Just do it. David helps solo consultancies, and business coaches grow their revenue by 50 to 500% in less than 15 months. Now, you'll note that I said solo consultants and business coaches, but I know from working with David for all these years that his key concepts, his ideas, his marketing strategies, his sales strategies apply to all businesses, which is why he's here. And I love the fact, David, that nothing makes you happier than a client who's getting great results, except maybe a puppy, right?
You can't argue with puppies. That's hard to beat.
No, you can't. And I think we both share our love for puppies. You have a lab, I think, right?
She's actually a golden retriever.
Oh,
Golden
golden
retriever.
retriever.
Yeah.
Yes, that's right. That's right. Yes, my dog, or as one of my clients calls him, my couch pig, because she lies on the couch behind me a lot when I'm working in other offices, and they just see her lying there.
The classic upside down dog pose.
It is, absolutely, absolutely. We do love them. Okay. So let's talk about your book because when did your book come out?
The Do It Selling book came out at the beginning of May of 23, just about a 5 weeks ago.
So, I'm curious. You have Do It Marketing and Do It Speaking and now Do It Selling. What inspired you to write this book?
Well, it's funny. The Do It Marketing book is about 30% sales content, and I had to sneak it in. Because so many people like, oh, I love marketing, but sales is scary. I don't know about sales. Sales is scary. And then speaking, of course, the whole Do It Speaking book was around the premise that speaking for executives and professionals and sales pros is a really fantastic one-to-many lead generator, and it's a one-to-many sales platform. So whether you're doing paid professional speaking like you and I might do, or just speaking to generate leads, how to market your expertise as a speaker, that book was about 30% sales. So knowing that 30% of book one was all about sales and selling, 30% of book two, all about sales and selling. And most of the people that come across my radar, they think they have a marketing problem, but when I give it a little bit of a closer look, they really have a sales problem. And so that's what inspired me to write the book, because Do It Selling is 100% about sales and selling, not just 30.
Absolutely. Okay. So speaking of problems, what do you think the two biggest problems or obstacles to sales success are?
Number one, it is lack of enough prospecting activity. And sometimes that means total lack of prospecting activity. So sometimes I will say to someone, so how much proactive prospecting are you doing? And if they don't want to get the finger wag from me, they will say, you know, David, I'm not doing enough. I know I'm not doing enough. I'm like, okay, how much exactly? Zero. So yes, zero would be in the category of not enough. So not enough prospecting activity, including zero prospecting activity. And then number two, thinking of sales and selling as this very adversarial, you know, we have to have targets, and we have to, you know, we have to take them down, and we have to, you know, knock them out, and all of this kind of adversarial language that I think has just seeped in to some sales cultures in a very negative way. It's almost like, and even sometimes we say, well, you got to go out there, Colleen, you got to engage with the enemy. It's like, no, you don't got to engage with the enemy. Number one, they're not enemies. They're friends that you simply haven't met yet. So having a much more collaborative and a much more human and a much more relevant and a much more connected philosophy and mindset about sales and selling, that will color everything about your sales conversations, your affinity for sales, your ability for sales, and how successful you are in truly and deeply connecting with people and not having that commission breath that just makes them feel like they're another number on your spreadsheet.
Absolutely. Commission breath. That's fantastic. I had never heard that before, but I will use it and quote you, because, you know, it's absolutely true. And I participate in a number of forums, including a big sales forum on Reddit, a sub on Reddit. And it's amazing to me how many sellers are still going through training where the sales trainer says things to you like, just get in front of the audience and tell them what your, you know, pitch them what your value is. And if they say no, just keep telling it to them louder and faster until they say yes. Like, what is going on here? Right. And, you know, especially, well, I mean, seasoned salespeople, experienced and successful, will just say no. New salespeople, that freaks them out, right? Because now it sounds like this adversarial, aggressive approach. And they think, well, if that's the only way I can be successful, then I want out.
Right, totally. I think one of the important principles that I really believe in is every sales professional is also a prospect. So once in a while, it would be very productive to take off your salesperson hat, put on your prospect hat, look at that piece of marketing or that voicemail or that email that you're about to send or that LinkedIn message, and ask yourself a very simple question. If I was on the receiving end of something like this, how would I respond? And when you really take yourself out of the situation, and I've had clients do this, where it's like, hey, David, I'm about to send this email to a prospect that I'm trying to get a meeting. What do you think of the email? And I will look at it, and it's filled. Number one, it's filled with I, me, and my messaging, right?
Yeah.
I want my company, my service. I'd love you to take a look at my stuff.
Yeah, I think.
It's instinctive, right? Because we always have this kind of I, me, and my filter going. And it's completely value-free. Number one, it's completely templatized. You can copy and paste that same exact message to 5,000 prospects. If it applies to 5,000 prospects, it applies to none of your prospects. So there's no customization. There's no tailoring. There's no relevance. There is no research that went into that. It's literally blanket everyone with the same message. And I said, do you ever get messages like this, especially on LinkedIn? I know LinkedIn is famous now for the connect and spam, connect and spam, connect and spam. Terrible salespeople that are out there trying that. I said, when you get those connect and spam messages, do you respond to that? And the client that I'm just having this conversation, they go, no, of course not. Never. I'm like, okay, so let's reread this again. Let's reread this again. Would you respond to this email? They go, oh, you're right. You're right. I didn't even see it, but you're absolutely right. So a little bit of tailoring, a little bit of customization, a little bit of personalization goes such a long way. And unless you're selling widgets, unless you're selling commodities like pencils, right? We are not doing a 25-cent sale or a $1.99 sale. We are doing sales for tens of thousands or hundreds of thousands, in some cases, millions of dollars.
Absolutely.
Are you telling me that your door opening campaign is batch and blast, connect and spam, and you're putting zero work into getting a meeting that might lead to a six-figure or a multi-six-figure sale? To me, Colleen, that's just insane. That's nuts.
It's totally insane. And, you know, you said a couple of things here that I want to revisit and reemphasize for everyone. You know, salespeople are also prospects, right? And I think it's interesting. I just had a conversation with someone on another forum where he said, like, if I'm a sales VP shopping for, you know, stuff for my sales team, stop putting me through your scripts and your process because I can see right through it. Like as a prospect, it's making me cringe. And he laughed and said, it's actually making me a better sales coach because I now realize what we can and can't do or should and shouldn't do with our sales team. And so I think that that's a really valuable thing for all of us to be thinking about. The other thing I think that's really interesting that you said there is, you know, you talked about sending emails that were templatized, right? Like I can. And the other nuance on that, that maybe was built in there is making sure that there is some customization because I can tell you, I mean, I get multiple emails a day, not just LinkedIn emails, but real emails who say things to me like, I'm really interested in helping you build your dental practice in Wisconsin. That was a real one. Or I love this one. I was in your office the other day and noticed that you had a physical sign-in book for your guests. I'm like, I'm looking around my office condo and thinking, no, you weren't. So like they're either blatant lies or they've done no research. That I'm like, what? I love sending notes back to people. What in my profile gave you the indication that I was a dentist in Wisconsin?
Now, when you call people on that, when you send those replies, which I love, by the way, do you ever get a response or do they just slink off in shame?
No. So sometimes on LinkedIn, they do respond and say, hey, I'm sorry about that. Often they blame their marketing departments, but when I send it back in email, they don't ever. But then I usually have some fun and put it up on TikTok as a video or.
Of course. Terrible sales pitches are wonderful material for people like us.
Yes. So, you know, you described as sales obstacles then. You know, a couple of things that are practical, right? Like let's do some customization. Let's not be aggressive. Let's, you know, think of ourselves as prospects and reread. But you also talked about some mindset issues here, right?
Yeah.
So like, why are people not prospecting?
I think they think prospecting is some, so a couple of things. Number one, they think it's some random, scary, bizarre activity. No one really teaches effective prospecting, except maybe you, me, and two other people who shall remain nameless because I'm not sure who they are. It's also seen, even by professional salespeople, it's somehow seen as beneath them. Like prospecting, like knocking on doors and emailing strangers and cold calling and no. I've been selling for 5 years. I've been selling for 15 years. I've been selling for 20 years. I don't prospect. I develop business. Oh, what does that look like? Well, breakfast, lunch, coffee, golf. Really? How effective is that? Well, you know, when they're ready, they'll just come and, you know, they know who I am and, you know, I build relationships, all these excuses. And you say, well, how many prospects have you gotten in the last 30 days from that? None. How many opportunities did you uncover in the last 90 days from all of that activity? Breakfast, lunch, coffee, golf? None. So even, I'm not saying don't network. I think networking can be incredibly effective, but don't passively network, right? Build it and they will come. Ever since Field of Dreams has been a sales mythology, but it's still around. It is still around.
Yeah, you say this in your book, right? You never know where your next sale is coming from. You know, if you're hoping for an inbound lead or a random referral to save you again.
Yes, right? This is total lack of any proactive sales process, which always starts with a prospecting process.
Yes. So let's walk through some of that because I am in 100% agreement with you. In fact, I have been known to say all sales starts with prospecting. Honestly, I've told countless audiences, I mean, I can teach you the world's greatest closing statements, but if you don't have anyone to close, it's not going to help you, right? Yes. Most salespeople don't have a closing problem. They have an opening problem. So,
amen.
I would love to dig into this with you a little bit and talk about what you think, like, where do you think people need to start here?
Sure. Well, I think people need to start with some clarity and some decisions. So when you ask, and again, this is my main work is with service professionals who are kind of accidental salespeople, but I think even professional salespeople. You say, well, who is your very best prospect? They go, oh, well, you know, we sell XYZ and everyone needs XYZ. I mean, we're in 27 different industries. We're in 13 different verticals. We sell big, we sell small, we sell industrial, we sell to wholesale, we sell to distribute. It's like, I didn't ask you about the whole portfolio. I said, what do you want to focus on? Who is your best prospect? And once they've made a decision, and let's say it's distributors for whatever thing it happens to be.
Yeah.
It's like, well, you know, I have most of my volume comes from selling into the distributor channel. Those people know me. They love me. I know where they live. I know what they want. We have a good rapport. I said, great. Well, stop everything else. That's decision number one, is stop distracting yourself with low payoff activities when you already know what the high payoff activities are.
Yeah.
And then get to know the ecosystem around those distributors.
Interesting.
So where do they go? What do they read? What events do they go to? What awards are in their industry? What are the trade publications? Who are the media companies? Who else wants a piece of that same market that you could start to tap into that larger ecosystem and not only build relationships with the people that are in that target market, but build relationships with people who are adjacent to that target market. And also they might be may be some collaborations, there may be some referrals, there may be some strategic introductions, there may even be some co-marketing or even some projects that you create together. And stop trying to go it alone. Stop trying to go it alone. But getting to know the ecosystem is really vitally important because then you know, like when you wake up in the morning, what do I write about? Where do I go online? What blogs, portals, groups, communities should I be a part of? Where do I need to start adding value and being part of conversations in the industry where my ideal prospects, they're already complaining, they're already asking questions, they're already engaging, they're already commenting, they're already blogging about these issues. And it's like shooting fish in a barrel. So once you're focused in, and this is about niching down and really making the clarity and the focus and the decisions that you need to make, saying, I'm going to play in this sandbox. And once I draw the dimensions around this sandbox, everything with prospecting becomes easier.
And then it's
really about connecting with those people. And it's about serving before selling. And it's about helping before pitching.
Sure. So is this what you describe as decide and define?
Yes.
Okay. So decide who your best targets are, define the ecosystem, the box,
exactly
all around
right.
that.
Exactly
so then
right.
you can decide what the right prospecting activities are for them.
Yes.
Yes.
And, you know, I think the other mistake that people make with this is they think they're serving an industry. So you say, okay, well, who are your best clients? Tech industry, manufacturing, small business. Well, small business is 100 different industries. Manufacturing yeah. is 100 different industries, right? True. Tech, there's 100 different flavors of tech. So you're talking about a population of literally hundreds of thousands of prospects. Yeah. If you can zero in on exactly what kind of small business, exactly what kind of manufacturing company, exactly what kind of tech company. So if you say, well, you know, so let's say we meet at a networking event and yeah. I am the world's most connected human being. I'm not, but just pretend. And I say, Colleen, you could meet anyone in the universe. And I've got thousands of contacts in every imaginable area because I'm this super magic networker. All I need to know is exactly who would you like to be connected to? And if you told me, well, David, it is SaaS companies between 1 to 3 years old that have between 10 and 100 employees and between $1 and $50 million of revenue. I'm like, okay, great. Here's 792 of those. Yes. How much business could you develop from those 792 laser-focused, very specifically defined prospects? Probably millions and millions and millions of dollars. The other test, as I know what we're broadcasting here partially on LinkedIn, is could you go into LinkedIn Sales Navigator? Could you check the boxes that are provided in Sales Navigator? And could you come up with a very yeah. clear prospect list? If the answer is, oh no, it varies too much, then you don't have a real prospecting strategy.
Absolutely. So, you know, here's what I think is happening. I think that salespeople, consultants, trainers, speakers who are struggling don't want to define that audience too narrow because they want to scoop up everybody because they don't have enough in their pipeline to close the best deals. So they keep it broad so that they can take every little piece of business, good, bad, you know, or whatever.
Yes.
And so it's a huge catch 22, right? Because they're creating problems.
Well, it's
problems
the moment, but all this, so you have to take this leap of faith, and really it's not a leap of yeah. faith. I tell my clients and audiences, it's a leap of logic. Not a leap of faith, it's a leap of logic. Leap of logic,
write that down, everybody. It's a leap of logic.
Exactly, leap of logic. Once you narrow in on that specific target market that you've made those decisions and you've got that defined target market, people always think they're leaving money on the table. What they're actually doing is they're blowing money out the window if they yeah. don't do this. So once you become crystal clear, the go-to choice, for those exact people that have those exact problems, you now start to elevate yourself, even with those two decisions, really, without yeah. doing anything else, you've elevated yourself to specialist status. And yeah. one of the things that I write about and rant about all the time is that, experts win on value, specialists win on value, and generalists die on price.
Yeah,
so if you're a generalist, you are easily interchangeable with every other generalist who does what you do, who sells what you sell, or who looks like you look. Yeah. Even if they're wrong, it's like, oh, but we have the super duper technology. Oh, we have the patented process to do X, Y, and Z. We're the only ones that do. They don't care because you look the same. The reality yeah. doesn't matter. The perception of sameness is what's killing you. When you raise your flag and you're loud and proud, here are the people that we serve, exactly the people that we serve. Here are exactly the problems that we solve. Now you flip the script, and now they need to qualify for you. So you become Harvard, Yale, and Stanford, or in yeah. our case, also we'll add McGill.
Yeah.
You become Harvard, Yale, Stanford, and McGill.
There we go.
You are the prestigious institution, and prospects need to apply. Right. Yes. Many apply, few are accepted. And now we are in an authority position in our marketplace instead of being seen as a peddler.
Absolutely. Now, we have a question from an organization in Tanzania, which I think is an interesting one. I'm going to put it on the screen here because it is directly tied to what we're talking about. They are asking how they can become trusted and supported by people. And I believe, and you started in on this earlier, talking about really defining your audience. So, you know, obviously people in Tanzania.
Yes, people is the first red flag I saw.
Right. Well, making sure they know who the quote unquote, make sure you know who the people are.
Right.
And then you talked about, what am I going to write about, speak about, share content about? And I believe you become trusted by building that expertise. So in answering this question, and maybe you can be a little bit more general, how do you decide, like, let's talk about that content creation so that people can become trusted by their audiences. What should they be writing about?
Sure. So there are selfless and selfish. Even the selfish way is effective, though. Selfless and selfish ways to share content online, meaning blogs, videos, all of your social channels, YouTube, LinkedIn, TikTok, etc. The first thing is to be radically relevant and radically valuable so that when they read that piece of content, when they watch that video, when they listen to that podcast, people will say, oh my gosh, I felt like you were talking to me. That is exactly what my problem was. That's exactly what we're wrestling with right now. That's exactly what our, you know, let's say, I'm guessing this is a nonprofit of some kind.
Yeah.
And you may be going after foundations or funding sources or grants. If you can zero in, what does that funding source, what do they really want to support? If it's a grant, what does that grant-making institution, what's their mission? What's their vocabulary? What's their language? And if we can mirror the same issues and the same language and the same goals and the same priorities, where there's alignment between what the prospect wants and what you say you are providing and what the actual content that you are providing. So you're providing insights, you're providing recommendations, you're providing guidance, you're providing smarts that will help that target market do better. That's number one. The second, so that's truly valuable, selfless content that will help you. Selfish content that will help you. Think of all the reasons that people would not hire you. Or in the case of Bisto, that would not donate, right? That what are the obstacles? What are the reasons that they would not engage with you? LinkedIn is a beautiful place to do this, but you can do this wherever your prospects are. I believe you should create objection buster content. Objection buster content is content that is designed to dissolve objections in advance in a generic way and not specific to any particular client or client situation. So let's say that, and we all know what all the common objections are. There's about, you know, 8 or 9 of them. No time, no money, no budget, got to check with the board, got to check with the CEO, got to check with my spouse, got to check with my spirit animal, you know, other decision maker, whatever it is. So time, budget, need, priority, authority, all of those things. Let's unpack each one of those. And let's say you put a piece of content out there that it says something like, why now is the time to solve problem X, Y, and Z. And then the narrative of that piece of content is, you know, I've been talking to a lot of prospect persona, right? I've been talking to a lot of CEOs, and CEOs are very concerned right now about the economic uncertainty. Is there a recession? Will there be a recession? Will more bank meltdowns? What's going on with cryptocurrency? What's going on with AI? There is so much uncertainty. Let me give you 3 reasons why now is the time to fix problem X that your company or your nonprofit is brilliant at fixing. Reason number 1, these problems will not go away by themselves. Reason number 2, dig your well before you're thirsty, right? So be proactive. Don't wait for the problem to get worse. And number 3, if you fix this now, even if there is an economic meltdown and more uncertainty, you'll be better positioned, you'll be stronger, you'll be ahead of the competition, blah, 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 blah. Now, that afternoon, you're on a call. Hi, well, you know, yeah, this is not a great time and there's so much uncertainty and there's recession and depression and bank meltdowns and crypto and AI. You can say, you know what, Bob, assuming his name is Bob. You know what, Bob, this is so funny. I just posted an article on LinkedIn this morning talking about this exact situation. Are you in front of your computer? Yes, I am. Awesome. Pop over to LinkedIn, type in my LinkedIn URL, or I'll send it to you here, right here on Zoom. And let's look at that article together. So what you just said is problem number 1, objection buster number 1. Does that resonate with you? Yeah, no, David, I guess I kind of see your point there. Number 2, number 3. And it's beautiful because you can use that week. You can use it that month. You can use it that quarter. You can use that piece of content forever. So yes, think about exactly. The 8 or 9 most common objections that you get. Imagine if you had 8 or 9 anchor LinkedIn posts over the last couple of months that address every single one of those major objections that you constantly get. Do you think you'd be able to work through more of the objections and bring some rational conversation to those objections? The beauty of this is you don't need to think of it in the moment. So there's no pressure, there's no stress, there's no arguing. It is the entry point into this, Colleen. It is so funny, Colleen. I just wrote a LinkedIn post about this very thing last month. Are you in front of your computer? Yes, great. Let's have it together. And now it's neutral. It's not about Colleen. It's about everyone.
No, that's really neat. I like that idea a lot.
And because everyone I'm talking to has these problems, I'm kind of an expert on help you work through these problems.
Yeah, absolutely. So, you know, a couple of things that I want to be clear on for people. When we're talking about content, we're not talking about salesy content, right?
Correct. Like,
we're not talking about sharing on LinkedIn 101 reasons why you should buy from me and why
totally
I'm the best.
Not.
And
right.
Oh, by the way, here's my special and here's my set of steak knives and, you know, all those
right.
things. We're talking about, you know, sharing content that can help them. And David, I can't remember who said this, but, you know, you and I are connected through the National Speakers Association, and it was someone from the main stage. It may have been Alan Weiss, actually. He said this resonated with me, and it has for my entire career as a consultant. Give so much value away in your writing and your blogs that people say, my God, I learned so much from her for free. Just imagine how much value I'll get if I pay her.
Yes.
Because I think that a lot of people, salespeople think, man, if I publish how-tos or to-dos and things, they'll just do it themselves. But most people won't, right? And I truly believe we are in a market, we have been for a long time, where people have to see the value in order to get proof that you're an expert and to trust you. So the content should be really focused on you thinking, okay, how can I help this person without them paying me? If they read this, how will they be better off as a result, right?
Yes.
So I think that's great. Do you have any tips for how often people should be, like, well, we're on the topic of social media and blogs and things like that. How often should people be posting on their social media sites or sending out a blog?
Well, so there's two things. There's content creation, which is not, in my book, it's not money-making activity. And then there's engaging prospects with your content that you've already written.
Yeah.
Blogs, videos, webinars. It can be used for all kinds of things. Not just objection buster content,
sure. But
educational content, you know, insight content, sharing relevant content that will help them. I think at least once or twice a week,
okay,
you should be in front of a camera, in front of a webinar, in front of a keyboard, typing valuable, relevant, useful, actionable content. And it totally engenders the spirit you're talking about, Colleen. Oh my gosh, this free stuff is so good. Imagine if we became a client. Imagine if we became a customer. So one of the things I talk about in the actual Do It Selling book is I call this pre-sale value. Every single person watching and listening to this, I guarantee your post-sale value is amazing.
Yeah.
Whatever product or service you deliver, it is a total home run. It's fantastic.
Yeah.
Why don't we take some of that post-sale value and put it before the sale so that before you get paid, the pre-sale value is commensurate with the post-sale value. And then people are like, oh my God, this is great. How do I get more of this? Well, the way you get more of this is you become a client. The way you get more of this is you start buying our product, our service, our program. Not that you're holding stuff back, but we're so stingy sometimes, right?
Yeah,
so back in internet 1.0 days, there was the old saying about 80-20. So, you know, 20% of your content you put out there in the marketplace, 80% you keep for your clients. 80% of the good stuff is for your paying customers. Now I would say it's 20-80 the other way. I would even say it's 10-90. Maybe it's even 5-95. That you give 95% of your most amazing, valuable insights as a company, as a sales professional, put that into the marketplace. And the 5% that makes all the difference, Colleen, is what you just put your finger on. I can give you the exact perfect step-by-step, blow-by-blow of anything, and you will not be able to implement it.
Yeah.
If you work with us, you will be able to implement it. You will get the product. You will get the service. You will get the done for you, whatever it is. So it's the implementation that makes the difference, not the information.
Yeah,
so
absolutely.
Anyone that's watching this right now that you've been kind of hoarding your information, I guarantee the moment you stop that and you put it all out there for the world to see, or your world, your prospects, you will double and triple your sales effectiveness almost overnight, because now you're externalizing and you're demonstrating your industry expertise.
Absolutely. So, you know, I wanted to just share this comment that we got that Lou sent, which is wonderful. I'm glad, Lou, that we're helping, you know, finding ways to provide you relevant and helpful information. And you're absolutely right. Like, in today's business environment, we have to be positioned as experts, which is what we're talking about here. You know, I get into raging debates with people all the time about the fact that cold calling is dead, and people misunderstand what I say about that. The calling is not dead. We ultimately, no matter how many blog posts or LinkedIn posts and expert, you know, networking events you go to, you ultimately have to pick up the phone and call someone or take a call and talk to them. What people don't want to do, though, is talk to a random stranger they know nothing about and are now finding themselves on the receiving end of a pitch.
Yes.
Right? So
yes.
There comes a time, you know, there comes a time when you have to pick up the phone and make a call, right?
Yeah, for sure.
Do you have, you know, and I think I thought it was really interesting. One of the things that you say in the book is don't worry about sounding smart.
Yeah.
But also, I'm going to run through these quickly. Don't worry about being liked.
Also true.
So, you know, how, I guess the question is like, how many calls should you be making, or who do you decide when you should be calling, and how do you kind of square these two things? You don't want to, don't worry about sounding smart, but I also want people to like me.
Sure.
Right.
So a couple of questions squished into there, and I'll try and address all of them. Don't worry about being liked and don't worry about sounding smart is about the way that you have your conversations. So when we're worried about sounding smart, people will say something to you and you will accept that at face value because you're afraid, oh, if I ask a question about that, I'm going to look dumb. If I ask, if I'm not sure exactly what they mean by that piece of jargon, I'm going to seem ignorant, and I don't want to seem ignorant. So my answer is, got it. Yes, of course, that makes sense. And they're telling you just very broad information that you have no idea what that means. So you know what, Colleen? Our retention numbers aren't as high as we would like. Got it. You know, we're having a real problem with the culture on our team. Of course you are. No, a lot of my clients have big culture problems. Got it.
Yeah.
Any one of those statements deserves 17 follow-up questions because you need them to quantify and specify exactly what they mean. So never let a squishy answer come in. That's about, don't worry about sounding smart. Don't worry about being liked. When we worry about being liked, we spend most of the sales call showing them how useful we are, how friendly we are, how easy we are to get along with, how personable we are.
Yeah.
And what does all of that lead to? Talking. Way too much talking. So please remember this, my friends. Our prospects will always judge us far more on the questions that we ask than on the statements that we make. So if you're worried about being liked and doing the happy puppy, like, and being the lapdog in the situation and just, you know, you're building way too much rapport and you're talking about their hobbies and you're wasting all of the sales time. And then, you know, you're totally obsequious and you're totally, you know, you're letting them run the show. You're letting them drive the call. You've abdicated your sales leadership position. All of these things lead to disastrous selling outcomes, meaning they will not take you seriously. This is why prospects disappear. I talk about the disappearing prospect syndrome being a really deadly disease called DPS,
yes.
Disappearing prospect syndrome. they go dark on people like that because you're a giant waste of time. So please, please, please understand that every moment in a sales conversation is valuable, and every moment in a sales conversation is your opportunity to find out what's really going on with that prospect and to do a very thorough deep dive discovery.
Exactly. So I think this is a good time to actually transition or add on here. You know, you say that a key principle is don't tell them about your smarts, show them.
Yes.
Right? Deliver a powerful experience of value and make this a call they'll never forget.
Yes.
So can you give our listeners, our viewers, a couple of tips on how to do that when they pick up the phone and call someone?
Of course. So let's say that we have an initial meeting on the book. So we've agreed either by email or some other, an initial quick call. Yes, there is some initial interest. Someone raised their hand, would love to do a 30-minute chat, find out what you guys have going on. Great. Perfect. At the beginning of that call, when I say treat prospects like clients, you want to also communicate that you're treating that prospect like a client. And so my first question is, Colleen, great to connect with you. For the purpose of our call today, do I have your permission to treat you like a fee-paid client? And each word of that is very, very specifically chosen. Do I have your permission to treat you like a fee-paid client? Because and at that point, they're going to say, well, sure, David, but what does that mean? I said, thank you for asking. It means a couple of things. Number one, it means I'm going to try and give you as much value and as much insight on this call as humanly possible, as if we were starting our work together. Number two, because we're starting our work together, I'm going to ask for your permission to interrupt or redirect when I feel the conversation would best serve you if we took in a different direction. And then the third and final thing is, I'm going to tell you some things that you need to hear, not things that you want to hear, which is also what I do with my paying clients. Do I have your permission to do all three of those things? Now, think of the stature that you've just gotten permission for. Number one, I'm going to make sure that you get maximum value from our time as if we're starting our work together. Number two, permission to interrupt and redirect. Number three, tell you what you need to hear, not necessarily what you want to hear. Think about every sales call gone wrong.
Yeah.
If you had those three permissions, you would have probably made many, many, many more of those sales.
Yeah, this is a great question. I've never thought about this question before, and it has a lot of applicability with product sales, software sales, those of you who might be, you know, selling a SaaS platform, healthcare, because it does create that sort of head cocked, sort of like, what the heck are you talking about? Kind of comment. And you're able to say, I want to give you a lot of value, right? I love that. I also really love this redirect, because people will feel there's a slightly different mindset when you're dealing with a customer who's, you know, a paid customer versus a prospect. So it's a really nice way to open up the conversation. You guys know, because I say this all the time, you have to differentiate yourself in the sales process. And this is a question that I don't think very many people are using. And so if your prospect hears that from you, they're going to say to themselves, well, this is unlike anything I've ever heard before. So when you do that, you then don't fall into that trap of being commoditized, right? Which we talked about.
Absolutely right. So absolutely.
I love that. That's a fantastic question. A great takeaway for everyone. Quick question for you, a bit off topic. Is your book available as an audiobook?
It is, yes. So it's available in hard copy, and
perfect,
it's available as an audiobook for folks that prefer to listen instead of read.
Yes. We had someone comment that they are sight impaired and they were wondering how they could listen to the book. So I just wanted to make sure that we got that out there for everybody.
So glad. And whoever that is, we will be talking for 5 hours. I will be in your ear for 5 hours and you will love it.
That's great. I love that. Audiobooks are fantastic that way. So while we're talking about this sales conversation, do you have a roadmap for helping to make those sales conversations more effective?
I do. So think about it like a doctor, right? You come into the doctor's office And they don't just start shoving pills into your hand and saying, here, take the orange ones. The medical process, if it's done correctly, and if it's done ethically.
Here in Florida, they do say things like that.
Yeah, so. maybe. Diagnosis, prescription, treatment, outcome. So think of a four-part conversation roadmap, and you are not allowed legally. Colleen is not going to let you, both in the U.S. and Canada. Colleen's going to forbid you from moving on to the next step until you have really completely and thoroughly worked on the step before. So diagnosis is all of the uncovering, all of the questioning, all of the data collection, all of the question collection. So one of the things I say is, hey, if we were to start our work together, what's the first thing you would ask me? Well, David, I'm not sure how to do this or how to do that. Or, you know, we're looking at maybe, you know, investing in this or investing in that. We're not sure. I never answer the question in the diagnosis phase. We are simply collecting the questions. Once they become a client, then of course, now we know where to start and now we know what questions to have. So think of this way in the diagnosis phase, low-level people, low-level prospects want their questions answered. High-level prospects, the kind you and I want to work with, they want their answers questioned. So they might be totally set in a certain area, but we start probing, we start digging, we start uncovering, we start peeling the onion, and they say, wow, I've never thought about that question that way. That's really interesting. Maybe that strategy isn't quite as good as we thought. Maybe that initiative that we're about to launch is a little bit misguided. Maybe you can help us do it better, smarter, stronger, faster. So that's the diagnosis piece. Once you get to prescription, which if you're in professional services, it's some kind of proposal. If you're in the product business, it's some sort of other document. But it's like, okay, how are we going to solve this problem? If you've done the diagnosis correctly, guess what goes into the prescription? Their language, their words, their priorities, what they said they want to move the needle on, what success looks like in their terms, not yours.
Yeah.
And then what is the return on investment, right? How will they get this money back 3x, 5x, 10x, or 100x that they're investing with you to solve this problem or get this outcome? And then we have treatment. And treatment is, well, you know, how would you want to handle this? We can go small, medium, large, or supersize. And small, medium, large, and supersize are the different treatment options.
Yeah.
Obviously, if you give small, medium, large, and supersize based on what they shared with you, you are going to have a recommendation. And it's not always the biggest or the most expensive, but it's going to be a recommendation. You know, based on what you shared with me, Colleen, it really sounds like, you know, option two would be kind of the sweet spot of where you want to be. We could do less, but I think you'd get less results, honestly, and we could do more, but I'm not sure if the bang for the buck is there to do more. Now, imagine on the trust meter, when you said, hey, there's four options, I'm recommending option two. It's the second least expensive, right? I'm not even saying go for three, go for four. Let them sell you on three. Let them sell you on four.
Absolutely.
I can't tell you how many times, I'm sure this has happened to you, Colleen, where you're like, you know, I think option two would probably fit the bill. Like, oh, Colleen, we want more. We don't want the 6-month program. We want the 12-month program. We don't want this for 8 reps. We want this for all 24 reps.
Exactly.
So let them sell you on more. And then outcome is we always sell the outcome. We do not sell the prescription. We do not sell the treatment, the bits and the parts. We always sell to the outcome.
Absolutely.
What does this look like when the problem is solved? What does this look like when the outcome has been achieved? Talk about that 90% of the time, because the how is the least interesting part of this whole discussion.
Absolutely. So, you know, I think a couple of pieces of nuance here for our audience. I'm a huge believer in presenting options as proposals, just never more than three.
Yeah.
we have found if you're like,
good, there's better, best.
Different ways to do this.
Totally.
And good, better, best, absolutely. But they all have to solve the problem. You can't have, here's a partial solution, here's slightly more of a solution, and here's a complete solution,
right,
because that's
right.
Unethical, right? So I just want everyone to be clear on those things. And David, you're absolutely right. When we do this in our own business, people will often say, and I love it when they do this, well, you know, we actually want a bit of a hybrid between two and three. Like, can we take this from three and add it in? Or can we take, and now they're creating their own solution, right? And when they do that, they're not going to throw it away.
Totally.
So I think that that's, you know, for me, it's a huge mistake because, and you've heard me say this before, when you move from this, you know, here's the solution, take it or leave it, one option, to multiple, which would you prefer? You move the prospect's question from should I do business with David to how should I do business with David? It's a fundamentally different question that the prospect is asking themselves. And because of that sort of, you know, choice, you drive up your conversion ratios.
Absolutely. So, well, and that's why I said, if you do the prospecting process the right way, where it's really valuable, even the questions that you ask and the insights that you share in the sales process, whether they buy or not, if that has been valuable, the prospect isn't wondering, well, I wonder what it would be like to work with Colleen. It's like, oh my gosh, this is awesome. And now their question shifts to, do I want to continue? Because I'm not trusting that you're going to be amazingly helpful and amazingly relevant. Yeah. I'm not just trusting that you have some insights into my business. You have proven to me, you have shown me that you have insights into my business and really valuable, challenging questions. And now it's like, well, I don't want this to stop. So how can we keep this going?
Absolutely.
How can we get started? How soon can you start?
Absolutely. I wanted to encourage everyone to keep your questions coming. If you've got any questions for David or I, you know, text them in whatever application you're using to watch this so that we can get the questions. And while we're talking about this sort of proposal and getting towards the close, let's talk about talking about pricing, because this is a huge hang up for a lot of people. You know, on the consultant, speaker, trainer side, I find it hard because people think, oh, we're talking about the worth about themselves. But a lot of salespeople also have a hard time just saying it's $100,000 or whatever.
Yeah. So
how do you suggest we do that?
So I am a huge believer that you need to bring up numbers early and often. So how many times, and this is where sales typically totally go off the rails, we are having a beautiful, fantastic conversation, you and your prospect. And we're using words, and words are composed of 26 letters of the Roman alphabet. And then we get to the end and they say, well, this is great. How much does it cost? And now we leave the realm of words and we go into the realm of numbers. And there are these 10 little pesky digits that we know as the numerals. The first number that comes up in a conversation is your fee. And that is a crazy, crazy, crazy thing to do. So, you know, they're always afraid of your number. Guess whose numbers they're never afraid of? They're never afraid of their own numbers.
Yeah.
So if you bring in numbers way earlier in the conversation and ask them about what's it costing to have this problem in terms of dollars, hours, percentages, wasted time, wasted effort, rework, manufacturing defects, hiring recruiters to replace their people. Can you give me an idea of what that is costing you in terms of dollars?
Yeah.
So, you know, sometimes people have a hard time asking, like, well, what's that costing you? That just sounds weird. Can you give me an idea of what's that costing you in terms of dollars?
Yeah.
Well, that's not even the worst of it, David. It's also costing us hundreds of hours, really. So how many hundreds of hours and what level of person? Well, it's our administrative team and they're blah, 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 blah. So it's like, if it's costing us hundreds of hours and, you know, thousands of dollars, and then it's also costing hard dollars, you want to be collecting all this information.
Yeah.
Right? So you want to be collecting time, money, percentages, dollars, hours, as much as you can. If they're giving you vague answers, here's another magic question. Can you put a number on it? 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 Where has that number been? Where would you like it to be? Where do you think that number is in terms of your competitors? What's the highest that that number has ever been? What's the lowest that that number has ever been? What does success look like? So our turnover, if our turnover was less than 5%, we'd be super happy. Where is it today? 15%. Oh my goodness. So I'm wondering, how many top level executives in this at this level How many executives have you lost in the last 12 months? Four of them. Wow. Is that a lot? Is that a little? How much is that? It's unacceptable. We're upset when we lose one and we lost four. I'm curious, do you ever use recruiting firms to replace those people? All the time. Well, how much was your recruiting bill for those four people? $120,000. So you see where this is going. I'm talking numbers, numerals, digits, dollars, hours, percentages, the whole time. If they then tell me that they have a $1.7 million problem, their numbers, not mine, all these numbers came out of their mouth. I said, so if you take this plus this plus this, it looks like that's about what, 1.7 million? No, closer to two. David, yeah, is closer to 2 million. And my solution is $200,000. I'll say, Bob, I have great news. Based on everything you shared with me, to solve this $2 million problem, we're somewhere in the ballpark of 200K. Is that in the range you were looking to invest? And now when you say, is that in the range you were looking to invest, we're having an adult-to-adult conversation. You give me 200K, I will solve a $2 million Absolutely. Problem. That's what I mean by put your fee in the context of value that they're getting. Absolutely. And the contrast of scale. Like, you give me one, I'll give you 10X back.
Absolutely.
If you did not have that conversation and we just stuck with the 26 letters of the alphabet, hey, Colleen, how much is this? You're like, well, Bob, great news, 200K. Bob's going to have a heart attack and fall over on his desk. Absolutely. I thought this would be like a $30,000 thing. What do you mean 200K? Because they have no context of value. There's no contrast of scale. And any number without a context is a number that's too high.
Absolutely. I totally agree with you. And you know, most salespeople are afraid to have that value conversation. They're afraid to dig into the numbers. Like, what I find is salespeople, and I say often salespeople are scared to talk about money. And I don't actually mean their fees or their pricing. I mean the money associated with the problem that they're trying, yes, to solve, because that number is often 10 to 100 times X of what their fees are. So you've got to get your head around that. Hey, we have a question. I know we've only got like 5 minutes left, but I do want to address this question because it's coming up a couple of times. Right, we have to go all the way back to the beginning.
Sure.
What's the opening line? So, you know, you've been sending all this stuff. You decide to call somebody. What's an opening line that you would use to explain why you're calling?
So I generally do not start with the phone. I will start with LinkedIn. I will start with email, but I would say the exact same thing. Okay. On the phone that I recommend you say in an email or a LinkedIn message, which is the following. Three parts, each of which will take between 7 and 10 seconds. So the whole thing is a 20 or 30 second opening. The first thing is a problem that person or that person's industry or company is experiencing. So a trend of some kind.
Yeah.
The second thing is directly connect it to something that you are absolutely certain of is happening in their company. How do you know? Research. You went to their website, you saw something in a trade publication, you went to their media page or their press release page, they announced a big initiative, whether it's good news or bad news, doesn't matter. Layoffs, expansion, contraction, they're opening up a new brand, they're hiring 600 new engineers in Kansas City, whatever it is. So let's say, well, I'm going to go to the engineering recruiting because it's a fairly boring topic. If I were sending an email, the subject line would be scarcity of engineering talent. And I'm sending this to an engineering manager of a company that I just heard because of the news media that they are hiring 600 new engineers in a new plant in Kansas City. So that's the headline. Hey, Bob, industry research shows that engineering talent is hard to come by. It's going to be even worse later in 2023. This may be a problem as you open your new facility in Kansas City.
Yeah.
My name is David Newman. I help firms like yours solve the engineering talent problem. Would this be worth a short chat? So industry research, specific prospect research, call to action is, would this be worth a short chat? If I send that as an email and I don't get a reply, I'm going to go to LinkedIn, see if I can find them on LinkedIn. They may be active there. They may not be. I do the same as a LinkedIn message. If you're in Sales Navigator, you can do it through Sales Navigator also. No response to email, no response to LinkedIn, then I will pick up the phone. And you'll probably get voicemail because very few people answer the phone, especially if it's a number they don't know. You leave the exact same three-line message as a voicemail, worth a quick chat. Please get back to me and let me know. Now, it's almost not worth leaving your phone number because they probably won't call back. But then I would email them the following day and the subject line is voicemail. It's like, hey, Bob, left you a voicemail yesterday. I know you're swamped. Please let me know if a chat about getting engineering talent for your Kansas City plant is a priority or not.
Yeah.
Right. And then again, if you really want to make yourself valuable, right, send a little bit of research, send a checklist, send a cheat sheet, send the link. It doesn't have to be your content. It could be industry content from a source that they would ordinarily read, recognize, and respect. So now you're acting as if you're hired even before you're hired. By the way, here's a research report from McKinsey that just shows about the trends and how this whole thing is going to get a lot worse.
Right.
By the way, did you see my article in Engineering Today from last month where I talk about the lack of engineering talent, blah, 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 blah? Here's the link in case you missed it. And you can see that we're doing all of these thought leadership activities. Here's my post on LinkedIn. Here's my article in Engineering Today. I'm also going to be an aggregator of other content that might be valuable to my prospects that I did not create, but I'm collecting and collating it. So I now have a data bank of valuable assets that I can send to prospects. I've now elevated myself way beyond. Think of all the recruiters going, hi, do you need some talent? Hi, you need some talent? Hi, you need some talent?
Exactly.
Trusted advisor versus peddler. The difference is huge.
Hey, so David, Virginia wants to know if these questions or if this formula is in the book.
Everything is in the book. Oh my God. There are literally hundreds and hundreds of questions for every stage and phase of the sales process, when to use which. And you know what? I'm so glad that you asked this, Virginia. I'm not a big believer in set scripts. I'm a huge believer in frameworks. So the frameworks need to be congruent with your personality, your preferences, your strengths, the way that you talk. Right. So Colleen and I, for example, we have very different styles. We have very similar philosophy. But the way Colleen is going to ask these questions and get great results is completely different than the way I might ask the same exact questions and also get great results for my folks. So the framework, right? You want to freestyle within the framework. Make this personal to you and make this personal to your prospects, but freestyle within the framework so that you add your own personality to it.
Love that. Wonderful. David, we are just over an hour. And so I need to wrap things up. Now, I've got your website here, Do It Selling, to get the book. Tell us how else we can stay in touch.
Sure. Absolutely. So a couple of free resources. If you go to doitmarketing.com/manifesto, you can grab our Do It Marketing Manifesto. It's a 37-page PDF. Part marketing, part sales, part revenue growth. We also have a sales podcast. So if you love sales and selling and you're a student of the game, pop over to thesellingshow.com. And then Do It Selling does have all the companion tools, frameworks, templates, and training videos that accompany the book.
And I know from knowing David for so long that he really does practice what he preaches here. And so when you go to these websites or listen to these podcasts, you're not going to get a bait and switch. You're going to get high value content. Just as he said to Virginia, all of those questions and more are in the book. So I thank you. Just a quick public service announcement for everyone listening to join us next week on Friday at 11 o'clock Eastern time for my conversation part two on coaching for top performance with James Vincent. And I, David, want to thank you tremendously. We've had a lot of comments, as you've seen, about the high value, the relevance of the information. And I know people have been taking copious notes, and I wish you all the best. And thank you so much for being here.
So great to be here, Colleen. Thank you.
Hey, my pleasure. Thanks, everyone. We'll see you next week.